Marching forward with his life, Travis maintains his grueling hours as a taxi driver. Through the streets he sulkily rides, a scorned outsider, God's lonely man. At his lowest point, Travis, uncharacteristically, finally reaches out to somebody for advice. Characteristically, he has no idea how to express himself. He stutters and trips over his own words, saying essentially nothing of substance. The main message he gets across being that he has some real
bad ideas in my head.
The fellow taxi driver, a seasoned cabbie dubbed Wizard, recognizing that Travis is in a mental rut, responds with a simple recommendation that Travis just enjoy his youth.
Go on, get laid. Get drunk, you know, do anything. Because you got no choice anyway. I mean, we're all fucked.
Neither man really reaches each other. It's a back and forth akin to that of a son who never really knew his father. Wizard is far too above ground to give Travis a hand, and Travis is far too buried to properly reach up. Just as his bubbling rage has nowhere to conceivably let loose, Travis has no one to authentically bond with. Travis cannot explain himself. His pathology is not one to be conveyed by word of mouth. Rather, it must be mirrored, shown back to him. Travis may be incapable of self-expression, but he sure as hell can recognize his own reflection. And who better to lend him a helping hand in his time of dire need than himself?
I'm, you know, you must think I'm pretty sick or something. You know, you must think I'm pretty sick.
It is in director Martin Scorsese's surprise cameo that Travis has given somebody with whom he can deeply relate and grab insight from. A kindred spirit in his trough, just as Betsy was at his peak. However, by virtue of their relatability, this, of course, entails Scorsese's role as the mysterious passenger being just as mentally disoriented and disillusioned as Travis's. This eccentric passenger serves as a vessel through which the notion of violent retaliation is delivered to the all-too-absorbent Travis. Picking up the strange man, Travis drives him to a seemingly innocuous apartment complex, but upon their arrival, the passenger reveals a mania previously hidden.
Well, what do you think of that? I said, what do you think of that?
Having Travis park the cab a distance from the apartment building, he points out the silhouette of a woman in a top floor window. Training a sight on her, Travis acknowledges the woman's presence, and the passenger proceeds to reveal that they're spying on his wife. This, however, is not the man's apartment they are peering at. Rather, it is the abode of another man.
A nigga lives there. You're like that.
She is cheating on him, perhaps in Travis's view, just as Betsy is being unfaithful to himself. And the passenger, through his broken chuckles, then discloses his plot for a seismic recourse. Equipped with a 44 Magnum pistol, the passenger staked his intent to enact, as Travis would later deem,
true force
upon his better half.
Now, did you ever see what it can do to a woman's pussy? And that you should see. That you should see what a 44 Magnum is going to do to a woman's pussy, you should see.
Over the course of the interaction, Travis says very little, practically never making a peep. He simply gazes at his rearview mirror, seemingly enthralled with what is more or less a self-reflection. Maybe they're simply brothers in arms. While every other dialogue Travis has with his passengers, between himself and Palatine for instance, is shot such that himself and those in the back are distinctly separate and alien components, absent any emotional spark, there is a shot with this mysterious passenger which spells a true connection. While ominously and repetitively inquiring whether Travis considers him sick, the camera smoothly pans, rather than cutting, from the bearded visage of the rambling passenger in the back towards Travis's front-seated countenance, visibly ruminating in his intrigue. Whatever's churning up there, nobody can say for sure. However, the seeds have already been planted in his mind, and they shall grow for some time. This much is concrete. Immediately following this segment, Travis meets up with an illegal arms dealer, Easy Andy, to purchase, among other additions to his arsenal, a hulking, beastly 44 Magnum. The gun is large, no doubt, and it provides newfound lethal backing to the rage emanating from Travis's scorching intestines. He is toothed now. He's a walking one-man cavalry, or rather, he's a cowboy.
I'm gonna kill her. I'm gonna kill her with a 44 Magnum pistol. I have a 44 Magnum pistol. I'm gonna kill her with that gun. Did you ever see what a 44 Magnum pistol would do to a woman's face? I mean, it would fucking destroy it. Just blow her right apart. That's what it can do to her face. Now, did you ever see what it can do to a woman's pussy? And that you should see. That you should see what a 44 Magnum is gonna do to a woman's pussy, you should see.
One night, when visiting a local corner store, Travis is handed a free kill on a silver platter. Whilst perusing the groceries, the frantic accosting of a robber can be heard from off-screen. Slowly drawing one of his newly acquired hand cannons, Travis methodically steps over towards the counter.
Give me the rest of the goddamn
cash.
That's
all I got. What
you got more. Give me more.
Reach in your pocket. I got no money.
Reach in your sock. You got more bread.
That's it, man.
Give me the rest of the fucking bread.
Hey.
The kill is rather easy. One shot and the hooligan goes limp, his corpse slumped against the counter and easing onto the floor. There's not a modicum of glory in sight. The quandary is resolved untheatrically, brusquely. To say it is unromantic would be an understatement. Now Travis, having halted a robbery in progress, is a hero. He's finally, as he would say, washed the scum off the streets. At least he's done his part. So why then does nothing change? Was it, as I noted, too easy? Not the right kind of prey? What? Quite literally, in the very scene following this one, Travis is shown, once again, stationed in front of his television, listlessly tapping his head with the barrel of his 44 Magnum while consumed by footage of couples on a dance floor. He's again left broiling in furious longing as his unrectified isolation flares up once more. Why do they all have the pleasure of blissful, compassionate swinging, and I don't? He almost certainly demands in his seething. Though Travis may be recalled fondly by the corner store attendant for his acts of chivalry, he remains the detached bystander in a broader world which has left him, or has he left it. It moves happily and flails vivaciously without his presence. It does not need him. If only there were someone who did.
You piece of little bitch! Fucking son of a bitch, you! I'll kill you!